Draw down the word in the context of climate means the first time that greenhouse gases peak and go down on a year-to-year basis. So that's what drawdown means in the context of climate science. The organization, Project Drawdown, its purpose was to name the only goal that makes sense for humanity, which is drawdown, which is to reverse global warming. Right now, what you hear from the climate establishment, from the IPCC, from COP21, 22, 23, soon 24, is mitigation, 2C, 2050, curbing, reducing, you know, carbon neutral. All of those things make no sense whatsoever, given the fact that the actual greenhouse gas levels in the atmosphere are the highest they've been in 20 million years. When you add nitrous oxide, methane, HFCs to CO2, in terms of the CO2 equivalency, we're at 490 ppm. And the Paris Agreement is talking about capping it at 450 in 2050. We hit 450 in the year 2000. So it is going up so fast. So we wanted to name the goal, drawdown, so that we have something that makes sense. And second, we wanted to map, measure, and model the most impactful solutions that exist. That we're doing. We know how to do it. They're scaling. They're available globally, everywhere in the world. The science is proven. We understand the impact. The economics, we know. Those are the solutions we modeled. And we wanted to see if they continued to scale over 30 years, whether we could achieve drawdown by 2050. That's what Project Drawdown's about. The way we calculated the impact was all based on peer-reviewed science. So there's only two things you can do about the atmosphere, is stop putting greenhouse gases up there and bring them back home. It's only two things. You do the first by efficiency, clean energy, etc. You do the second, bringing carbon back home, by land use. Forestry, farming, grazing, oceans, etc. So the methodology was to go to the science. So every solution and the data in our book, on our website, is based on peer-reviewed science. Where there was a divergence in the science, which there often is, then we always chose the low median number. So every number on the impact is conservative, everything. We also measure the economic side, which is how much does it cost? Remember, every solution we modeled is existing. We can buy it now, it's happening. So how much did it cost? What would it cost over 30 years if it's scaling? And what would be the cost, or in most cases, the net savings? How much money would we save if we did this? And that data came from the International Energy Agency, the World Bank, the FAO, the IPCC, Bloomberg Energy. So all the data in drawdown is not, none of it is our data. All our data is the best data in the world on impact and on cost. And what drawdown does is reflect back to the world what we know, how much it costs, what we know how to do, because we're doing it, and the impact it will have if it continues to scale in a rigorous but reasonable way over 30 years. So it's not us telling the world, this is our plan, this is what we think you should do, we know something you don't know. It's the other way around. We're saying, this is what you know. Maybe no one has gathered it together in a book or a website. That's true. But what we gathered is what the world knows and what we as humanity know how to do. So it's a very different story than the narrative about things are bad, they're getting worse, and they're going to get even worse than that. We're not disagreeing with the science. We think the science is absolutely accurate. But we're saying that you cannot solve a problem by repeating the definition of the problem over and over and over and over. The problem contains possibility. So drawdown is entirely about possibility that's practical, hands-on. You can do it today, and this is what the world is doing. Well, we think that the idea of main solutions is actually a mistake. Now, we did measure by impact, so we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, no question. We measure by impact. But I believe that that has been error, because what you hear from Cristina Figueres, from Al Gore, from Jim Hansen, etc., is solar, wind, electric cars, and, you know, don't cut trees. And we've been hearing that for 20 years. And the fact is that those are crucial, crucial solutions, no question about that. But if we only do those things, we're still going to go right over the abyss, the cliff, into climate catastrophe. And what it's done to people is to think, well, I hope they, whoever they are, do that solar and do that wind and do that electric vehicle. And I hope they in the Congo and Brazil stop cutting trees. And as an individual, it leaves you thinking, I don't have any empower. Then, when we tell people what they should do, you know, this is a call to action, this is what you can do. They're important things, of course, you know, in terms of how many children, what to eat, about transportation, recycling, etc. But what we've done is we've placed the weight of it on the individual, as if the individual should be guilty or ashamed if they can't do those things or they can't afford to do those things. And what we've left out of that is community. This is a we problem. This is us coming together to solve it. It isn't an individual, and it's not some big corporation somewhere building a solar farm in Spain. It's cities and communities and neighborhoods and companies and farmers. It's all of us all over the world coming together. And so the solutions in drawdown are about a small group of people. We are 220 people who did drawdown. We're a collaborative, a coalition, and we're talking to the bigger we, right? So we're both we. And this is what we know, not we drawdown, but we know as humanity. And let's get together and do this, because we understand the problem, we respect the problem, the science is extraordinary, extraordinary. And repeating the science does not solve the problem. So let's go right at the problems. And so no one's ever done this before. We've never had a list of the top 100 solutions to global warming. Don't ask me why, I have no idea. 50 years in the public sphere, we've understood the problem, the science, the threat, no question. And we have great lists about the terrible things that are going to happen, are happening. We've never had a scientifically based list of the impact of the 100 top solutions to reversing global warming. When we model the solutions, we model it as a system. We don't model them separately because they are dynamic. So we didn't know ourselves what the top solutions would be until the very end. We sort of hit the total button, you know, like going to a store, you know, and then you find out how much you spent. It's the same thing with the model. You don't know until the end. And number 6 solution was educating girls, which of course surprised many, many people. girls around the world, millions and millions of girls every year are taken out of school at puberty. They are taken out because they don't have a latrine or a bathroom at their school, and they're, you know, becoming into menses, so they're embarrassed. They're taken out of school to go to work so that their brother can go to school. They're taken out of school for early marriage, tradition, culture, religion, whatever. They're taken out of school for many reasons. Poverty is another one. None of them are good reasons. That girl, if she's taken out of school, we know this, will have an average of 5+ children. If she is supported to go to school and matriculate to the lycée level, to high school, we say high school, she'll have an average of 2+ children. We've known this for 40 years. This is not new information. So it is a form of family planning, but it's not planning her family. It's supporting a girl to become a woman on her terms. She decides that she doesn't want a lot of children. She has a better education. She earns more. She wants to put those resources into fewer children so that those children have a good education and benefit and do better than her. And so that's the number 6 solution. The number 7 solution is family planning, which is clinics everywhere in the world to support women's reproductive health and well-being. You put those two together, and what you have is the difference between the UN high and median population projection for 2050, which is 10.8 billion or 9.7 billion, a difference of 1.1 billion people. The UN itself says it's entirely, almost entirely due to the presence or absence of family planning. And so you put 6 and 7 together, actually the number one solution to reversing global warming is to support women and girls, not a solar panel. And I'm not saying a solar panel is not important, it's extremely important. I'm not trying to, you know, but I'm just saying is, when do we ever hear about girls and women and climate? It's like they're two different universes, and we're saying, no. You know, and that's why the methodology we used was, say, agnostic. You know, we didn't have an idea of what should be 1 or 2 or 7 or 10. We didn't know. We did the math. We do mathematics. We do not do what we believe or what we think or what ought to be or should be. We do math, and the math is fascinating. Let's talk about high tech. The first solar panel was made in 1884. Okay. So solar has been around for 134 years. Just so. LED first came about in 1872. That's when the first diode was invented. Okay. 1960 is when somebody said, you know, these things produce a little light. Maybe we should try to see if they can produce more light. So one thing we should understand is some of what we call high tech actually goes way back historically in our understanding. Second, when we modeled the solutions, we used a subtraction sign, which is it takes energy to make a solar panel. It takes energy to make a wind turbine. We subtracted that energy out. So we're measuring net impact, not overall impact. So we're very aware that the things that we think are going to be saviors, you know, actually also have a carbon footprint. However, at the same time, the technology is really changing, especially in solar. I mean, their solar now, you can print it like a yoga mat, you know, and roll it up, take it home, it's $29, you can nail it to your cottage or cabin. It's non-toxic. There's no basically rare earth in it whatsoever. There's no heat used. There's no SF6, you know, which is a very potent greenhouse gas used in the sintering ovens to make silicon. So you're actually seeing a movement towards simplification. in lithium batteries, for example, okay, there is another area where you have, I wouldn't say lithium is rare, but it is not common, in, you know, and there's very few places on Earth where it exists. But you're seeing this movement to graphene nano, you're seeing the movement to carbon batteries, pure carbon, right? So I think you're seeing in these areas the initial technology could be complex, but because of costs and availability and impact, you're seeing the movement towards simplicity, better engineering, better innovation, better breakthroughs. So your question is very valid about impact, but I don't think we're going to stay where we are right today for the next 30 years. Well, to world leaders, I think it's important to point out that world leaders don't lead. Very few lead. They follow, and they follow, in many cases, money. Certainly in the United States, I can tell you that. And they follow who they think is going to vote for them again. So they follow a political party. Political parties are the most dysfunctional thing we have in the world. They divide people. They don't bring people together. So it's rare to have a world leader. And when we see a true leader like Nelson Mandela or something, you know, like that, we're so impressed, we're so happy, you know, like, wow, a real leader, you know, with integrity and vision. And so what I would say to world leaders is to become literate, you know, to become literate. And the other thing is, you're not very important. So don't think you're so important. What's important is for you to lead a life of meaning. And meaningfulness isn't to be elected, isn't to be powerful. It is actually to lead a life that actually supports the future of life. That's what we're talking about, right? And when you look at nature, anything in nature, what does it do? What does life do? There's life everywhere. What does it do? Life creates the conditions that are conducive to life. That's what life does. It keeps creating the conditions for more life. That's what a leader should do. So in economics, in policy, taxation, in education, everything should be about creating the conditions that are conducive to life, human life, but also biodiversity, the life of our climate, because it is a living system that interacts with the earth. And so that's what a leader should do. So my message to leaders is to become a leader, not become elected.